It is my great pleasure to bring up our distinguished visiting professor for the public dissemination of mathematics, Dr. Tim Chartier, who will be kicking off tonight's program. Please join me in welcoming Tim.
Thank you. To get us ready for tonight, I want to ask you to think of a time that you took a picture. You snapped it at that magical, perfectly timed moment. Then later, you looked with eager anticipation at your shot, only to see a blurry image that so imperfectly captured the moment. Blurry pictures aren't confined to cameras and phones. They also appear in medical imagery and astronomy. Tonight's speaker is a major researcher in this field of image processing, along with significant work in solid mechanics, materials science, and medical applications. The key is linear algebra. Secondary school is where many of us get a heavy dose of this topic, solving, for instance, x plus y equal 3 and x plus 2y equal 5, which, if you've forgotten, is asking for what values of x and y are both equations true at the same time. Our speaker, Dr. Malena Español, uses linear algebra to solve pressing problems in our world today. We might solve the two equations, x plus y equal 3 and x plus 2y equal 5, on paper or possibly in our head. Dr. Español solves millions of equations with innovative algorithms on a computer. Dr. Español earned her BS in mathematics from the University of Buenos Aires, Argentina, and an MS and PhD in mathematics from Tufts University. Her doctoral work focused on signal and image restoration. She then spent 3 years at California Institute of Technology working on methods that simulate the mechanical behavior of polycrystalline materials. In 2012, Dr. Español started a faculty position at the University of Akron, where she stayed until 2019, when she joined the School of Mathematical and Statistical Sciences at Arizona State University. Dr. Español was an editor for the Springer AWM series volume, Research in the Mathematics of Materials Science, which was released last week and highlights the research work of women in the area of materials science. Her list of involvement in the Society of Industrial and Applied Mathematicians is impressive and extensive. So it is my delight and honor to welcome Dr. Malena Español to the MoMath stage so we can all encounter the power and impact of linear algebra. Welcome.
All right, thanks. Thank you so much. So thanks for being here. Today I'm trying to talk about things that concepts that I struggled when I was in college, but these are concepts that are used these days every day in my research. So who likes to paint? Right, let's see. So primary colors are blue, red, and yellow. Why do you think they are primary colors?
I'm not sure you can combine any other colors and get them.
Any other? Yes, the next one.
Because you can use them, you can combine them to create any color that you want.
Yeah, so these are primary colors because we can use them to combine and create other colors. For instance, secondary colors can be used, can be created using them. So for example, the violet can be created using blue and red. The green color can be created using blue and yellow. And the orange color can be created using red and yellow. So what about tertiary colors? So for example, color purple is created using violet, which was a secondary color, plus a little bit about of blue. That was one of the primary colors used to create violet. So red violet, it's a violet with a little bit of red. So we can keep doing this way. So we have a secondary color, we get a little bit extra blue, and we get this blue-green, green color, a little bit more yellow again, yellow-green, and so on. So we can have these color wheels. Some of them are very old, right? Some are newer, but I wonder if you will, you know, sit down and try to put this relationship between the colors. I think these are very fun. So you can go to Wikipedia and see more of this. Now, I want to be a little bit more mathematical, and I want to write down the recipe of these secondary colors. But to do this, I want to think that I have actually buckets of paint. Okay? So I want to create one whole bucket of violet paint. And for that, I'm going to use half bucket of blue and half bucket of red. Same idea for a bucket of green. Half bucket of blue, half bucket of yellow. For a whole bucket of orange, I want half bucket of red and half bucket of yellow. And I want you to think this way because I really want you to imagine that you are doing it, okay? I want you to have this, look at this one half, and it has to have a meaning. They do have a meaning in this context. Now, let's look at the recipe of the color purple. Okay? So far the recipe says, well, we need half bucket of violet and half bucket of blue, okay, to get a whole bucket of purple. But let's remember, violet actually, to get a whole bucket of violet, we need half bucket of blue and half bucket of red. We don't really need the whole bucket because we actually need half of it. So let's do some math to see how much actually we need. So here is what is a whole bucket, okay? But we need half of it. So doing some algebra, we can actually see that we have half of the bucket blue. So we really need a quarter, one fourth of a blue, and we actually need a fourth of the bucket red. But let's keep doing math, right? This is the fun part of it. We really want to compress this formula and to say, from these two ingredients, we need this amount. So I put the blue and red here, and we only need 3/4 of the bucket blue, right? So we have this 1/4 and 1/2. It gives us the 3/4. I want to go one more step further and actually write this the color purple in terms of all of the primary colors. Okay, even though we don't need yellow here, but I want it there because I want to extend these ideas to other structures, not just colors. Okay, so again, let me stay here for a little bit and say yes. We are writing the color purple as a combination of these primary colors, and we have these 3/4 and 1/4 and 0 as coordinates in this system. Of course, we can do this for all the tertiary colors. Okay? Each of them will have a different way there, right? A different coefficient, a different formula, a different recipe. Okay. Now, I would like to think about what is your favorite color and how can you write it using this combination. For example, my favorite color is 100. So if I give you just the coordinates in this system, can someone else, if you give someone else this coordinate, can someone else guess that color? Now, some of you might, your favorite color maybe is pink. And to get pink, we actually will need to mix red and white. So we will not be able to find, to write pink as a combination of these. So you will have to change your favorite color just for a little bit. So, okay, so I'll give you some time so you can think about what is your favorite color, write it down without writing the color and see if the person next to you can guess it. And people online can do the same. And you can share online 110 Hayden. Let's see, that looks like violet. Yes. All right, so let's continue. So now I want to talk about primary colors of the light. There is red, green, and blue. These are the primary colors that are used for TVs and computers, and we look at them really as primary colors of the light in a little bit. But first, actually, I want to still think about them as paint. So here we have, you know, we wrote violet using the primary colors red, yellow, and blue. And I wonder if you could help me find, you know, how to write violet by using red, green, and blue. So basically, what we need is to find what is the amount, right, of red, the amount of green, and the amount of blue that mix will give us a bucket of violet. Right, so if we use democracy as a way to vote and decide, we have the 1/2, 0, 1/2. And yes, notice that in particular, violet also only need the blue and the red, and we have it in both, right? So in principle, we could have, you know, we don't really need to worry about zero in this particular case. I hope you can see that. Okay, so let's give it another try, a different example. Same idea, I want to represent the same color using these different primary colors. Ah, yes.
1/2, 1/2, 0.
Yes. So, do you want to say how you got there?
Green is yellow and blue, so it's 1/2.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. So here, and also in the Hayden in Zoom got also the answer. We have 1/2, 1/2, 0, and the reason is that the yellow and blue give you green, but you also can imagine that you have these buckets with you, right? So the idea is not just do math and the algebra, but actually be involved in the application and use the application to understand what we are doing, okay? So here, if you imagine that you have a quarter, 1/4 of the bucket of yellow and 1/4, when you put them together, you will get to 1/2, okay? So it only not this helps you not just to see what is the color that you need, but also how much, okay, that number there. Okay, and then 1/2 of red stays there, and yes, blue was mixed here, so there's nothing left. Okay. Now we have been talking about, you know, this coordinate system of colors. But, you know, when I think about a coordinate system, I really think about, you know, having a map and moving around, like trying to coordinate, right, to see where I need to go. So here we have a map of New York City, and imagine that you want to go from one place to another. Most of the streets are very orthogonal or perpendicular to each other, right? So if you want to go from one place to another, you probably will say, okay, you know, walk 3 blocks north and then 2 blocks east, okay? So that's the case here on the left, where I imagine that I want to go from 0 to this point, the 1, 1, and then this one gives us the directions, right? These are the blocks and the way I walk. So the coordinates will be, well, I just said 3 and 2, so this one will be different, right? But this basically says, move 1 block north and 1 block east. Now, if we get Broadway, right, that it's a diagonal avenue, we can just say, okay, do 1 block there, okay? Now, what I want you to notice here is that by changing the coordinate system, okay, we went from having coordinates that was 1 and 1 to having a coordinate that is like 1 and 0, okay? And even though this is a small example, I might not really make the point of where I want to go, I really want you to start thinking that we are trying to, for some cases, we will try to find coordinate systems where many of the coordinates are zero. Okay, and you can see a small example here. Now, I really want to go back to these primary colors of light and really want to talk about how we put images in the computer. But first, we need to really understand how the colors work in the computer. So we have this combination. But now, the way to think about who these A, B, and C are, I want you to think that no more paint. Now, I want you to think that these are light bulbs, OK? So in particular, for the computers, these numbers are, you know, computers use the binary system, OK? So numbers are only zeros and one, OK? So, and there is some restriction. So these coefficients, A, B, and C, are not amount of paint anymore, but now are numbers that have only eight bits, okay? Only eight numbers or combinations of zeros and one. So, okay, so if we put all zeros, we have the number zero. If we put all ones, that is equivalent to the 255 number, okay? So A, B, and C are going to be integers between 0 and 255. And I will say a little bit more, but first I want to tell you something that is super cool that you can do when you get home. If you go to your TV and take your phone, or your parents' phones, and get closer and zoom in, zoom in, zoom in, you actually will start seeing these sensors. And you will see that the TV has this red sensor, the blue sensor, and the green sensor. Okay? Of course, when we look at it, we all see these, you know, great colors. We don't see the sensors, right? So actually, our eyes try to do this combination that we talk about and get the right colors. Okay? So remember, this is a fun experiment. Okay. So I want to talk, you know, go back to, you know, this idea of having the light bulbs. So imagine that if we have a zero, right, A, B, and C are all zeros, you can think about them as all the lights are turned off, okay? So thinking that way, it is natural that this combination gives you the color black, okay? What do you think, how do you think that you can get the color white?
You set each color to 255.
Mm-hmm. Yes. I'm very good that in the chat we are also getting answers. Very good. Yes, exactly. So that means that if we put all the intensity, right, the maximum intensity for these light bulbs, we get the color white. And here I have a few more just to show you once again, how this works. If the green light or the green light bulb is off, right? I put zeros there and the same for the blue, and we only have the red one, you can see that by changing that number, we are getting different colors, okay? So a smaller number there, a darker red, and then we start putting more and more intensity, larger numbers there give us lighter reds. Okay, so we can really create all these colors just by doing these combinations of primary colors of light. Now, how many colors do we have? Well, if there are 256 numbers that we can put for A, and then 256 for B and 256 for C, these numbers, then we have more than 16 million colors. Wow, that's amazing, right? We cannot complain. We have tons of colors in our computer. Probably some of them we cannot even distinguish, right? But they are there. Okay, so I want to talk about digital images. Who has ever imagined or have an idea how digital images are in the computer? Oh, some of you, okay. So basically, if you take an image and you zoom in, at some point you are going to see these squares that have only one color in it, okay? So now, we saw that each color can be written as a combination of these primary colors, okay? Now, the most important part is really, if we want to create the color, what we really, really need is just the coefficients, okay? So, and, you know, we have many, many pixels here. So the idea is, how can we write or accommodate all this information about all these pixels all together? And the idea is, well, we are going to put it in an array, okay, of numbers. But let me just clarify how we do it. So here, I want to put the information that corresponds to this pixel that is in the fifth row and eighth column, okay? And the information is going to be, again, in the fifth row and eighth column in this array that corresponds to the red color, the same position, okay, for the green color, and the same position for the blue, okay? So the machine, the computer, knows that this combination, right, and it knows also that the first array corresponds to red and so on, will give this color, okay? So, kind of summary, okay, how do we store a picture in the computer? Well, we do need these three matrices or three arrays of numbers to, you know, each corresponding at each color. Now, let me just put some numbers, extra numbers there, but if you have an image that is 1,000 times 1,000, right, then you have a million of values, okay, of numbers, but actually you have three, right? So you have 3 million, so one image, 3 million of numbers, okay? Imagine all the things that you are saving in your phone, right? I don't think you save only one image. You are, right? You are saving thousands of images where each of them needs 3 million of numbers. So we actually need to be smart how we do this saving, okay? How we store images. Okay, so I mentioned matrices. So I want to kind of give a little bit more formality, but not much, okay? But here, there is an example. This is a matrix that has two rows, three columns, okay? So again, just think about matrices, array of numbers. This is a very kind of common, or I don't know what to say. But this is kind of the one of the matrices, right? So it has all ones in the diagonal and zero all around. Okay, this is called the identity matrix. Everything when we multiply, although I won't be talking about multiplication exactly, but when you multiply for this one, you always get the same, right? So if you have a number two, when you multiply by one, you get the two back, right? So it doesn't matter which one you use, you always get your number back when you multiply by one. This, something similar happened with the identity matrix. Okay, let's move on to symmetric matrices. Okay, do you see any pattern or anything that gets your attention in this in terms of patterns?
The digits are the same. So like across, it goes 1, 2, 3, 5, and up and down, it goes 1, 2, 3, 5, and it continues around that pattern for the entire matrix.
Okay, yeah. Yeah, so there is a pattern, right? These are exactly here, again, yes. So, yes, yeah, so symmetric matrices, okay, the entries are symmetric with respect to the main diagonal, right? That's why there is this symmetry, 2, 2, 3, 3, 5, 5, right? And this happened also in all the other entries, okay? Now, I want you to think this extra question. what is the cost of storing symmetric matrices? If we forget about the structure, we have a matrix 4×4, has 16 numbers there. In principle, we will just store 16 numbers. But there is a pattern there, right? If we know that the matrix is symmetric, we don't really need to store all the numbers. We only need to store the ones that have the information, right? So if we know that these ones are going to be the same as that, well, we don't really need to say them, right? So the idea is here, we can only store like 10 of the numbers here, and that will be enough if we want to build this matrix again. Okay, Toeplitz matrices. Do you see any pattern here? Oops. Something? Well, yes.
Well, look, they're symmetric against across the other diagonal.
Mm-hmm. Yes. So each diagonal has exactly the same number, right? So here we can see the main diagonal has the number 1, 1, 1, 1. Okay. Another different diagonal 2, 2, 2. Right. So in the diagonals we have the same number. Okay. Now the question: what is the cost of storing this matrix? If we ignore it, 16 numbers. But let's not ignore it. Okay. So, what do you think is the what do we need exactly to save? You know, what is the minimum that we need to save? 2n-1, the Daniel is saying. Let's make it just specific for this one. So here we only need to save the first row and the first column, right? We only need these 4, these 3, these 2, this 1, this -2, right? A representative of each diagonal, okay? So here, instead of saving 16 numbers, we are only saving 7, okay? So again, this is just a very simple example, but imagine that you have a matrix that is 1,000,000 × 1,000,000, okay? And instead of saving 1,000,000 to the square numbers, you are only saving 2,000,000 − 1, okay? So we are reducing, you know, storage, and it makes a difference in our cell phones, okay? And in our computers. Another kind of matrix, circulant matrices. So I'll give you also the chance. Can you see a pattern there? So we can see that the first row, right? We compare the first row and the second row, we see a shift, okay? And the fourth goes around. So between the row, the second row and the third row, we also see a shift, okay, to the right, and then this 3 number here goes around, okay? So every, from one row to the next, okay, we have the same, there's a shift, 1 to the right, okay? And the last number from the previous row goes around, I mean, that's a move, right? But this is how I actually imagine, right? All right. So yes, yeah, so, and, you know, of course, this is an important question. These are questions that are part of my research. Every time that I do something, I think about these kind of questions. So what is the cost of storing, right? So in this case, we only need the first row. All the information is there. Of course, we also need to know that this is a circulant matrix, right? It's not enough, oh, first row, right? We also need to know this is a circulant matrix, and the first row. Very good. Now, you know, we have numbers, we operate, we add them, same thing with matrices, right? So we, you know, I want to define what is the sum between two matrices. So as you can imagine, you basically, it's component-wise, right? So you take, for example, the 1, 1 element in the first row, first column, the first the element in the first row and the first column, you add them, and that the result of that goes to the first row and first column, and so on. Okay? So this is a component-wise. You take every element, okay, and you add it to the one in the same position, and that will go exactly to the same position as a result. Okay. Now, the question that I ask here is a little bit different. Okay? Here, we want to count the number of operations that we make, right? So before was, you know, we have numbers, how many we need to store. Here is, we have the matrices, and now we are going to operate. That has a cost. There's time, right? When we start, when we do it, right? It takes us some time. For the computer, it also takes time. So we want to know how many operations that this takes. So the way to count is, if we are doing this 1 plus 3, that plus counts like 1. Okay? If we do 2 plus 7, that counts as another sum. Okay? 3 plus 5, another, and so on. So how many additions are we making here? Let's see, the chat can just write down 16. Very good, Bob. Yes, so we are doing component-wise, so we have 16 of these additions. So again, imagine that you have a 1,000 times 1,000 matrix, or 1 million times 1 million, you add another 1 million times a million, you have a million times a million operations, okay? So, of course, we are not doing the calculation, so we will say, why do we care? But we do care. Okay? We need to try to be very efficient about how we use the computer. Okay, so let's see if we can actually, you know, be careful. So in terms of symmetric matrices, right? So we have two symmetric matrices, and we want to add them. Do you think the sum of them is still symmetric? Yeah, they are. Yes, yes. Yes. Right? So because it is component-wise, so we started with something that was already, you know, having this symmetry, and we add something that has this symmetry, right? But it's component-wise. So the result has also this symmetry, which means that we can not only, you know, when we have symmetric matrices, we can not only be careful about how we store the matrices, but we are also saving when we have to do operations, right? We don't need to do the operation with all of them because we already know the result of half of them, right? So when we do the operations, we do also half, okay? So here we can, you can start imagining that we might not even need to store or build these matrices. The only thing that we need is to have the right information, okay, and then know that we can do those operations, okay. All right. So homework for everyone is the sum of two toplets matrices toplets. This is for home. When you get back, to keep having fun. Is the sum of two circulant matrices circulant? Okay. So again, we saw how we, if the answer is yes, then means that, again, we are going to save in storage, okay, and we are going to save in computational cost when we add them. Okay. So I want to go back to this coordinate system, right? We talk about coordinate system of colors, we saw this, you know, moving on the streets or having points on the plane, and we have these also coordinates and coordinate system and the coordinates. We can really do the same with matrices. Okay. So, and these are like the standard coordinates, right? You can see that here you have a 1 and all zeros. These are for matrices that are 2 times 2, right? So I'm looking at not matrices in general, but I'm looking at matrices that are 2 times 2, 2 rows, 2 columns. And we have what will be kind of the standard coordinate system, where we have a 1 and the rest are zeros. Okay? And you can see here that if we write this matrix in this coordinate system, we get the coordinates 5, 5, 3, 5. Now, in the second row, I have a different coordinate system. Okay. Now, the part that I really want you to pay attention here is that in this new coordinate system, some of these coordinates are zero. And I don't know if you remember what I said at the beginning, but we really want to find coordinate systems where most of the coordinates are zero. Okay. So here we can see an example. So in particular, let me emphasize the following. This is a matrix that if we don't see any pattern, well, it's 2 times 2, not much pattern there. To save it, we need to save 4 numbers, okay? Now, what you can imagine is that, well, if we have a coordinate system, we could just, you know, transfer via the internet this information to someone else and give the coordinates, okay? Now, in the first row here, the coordinate system are basically 4 numbers. So it's not really that we gain having the matrix, this, you know, saving this 2 times 2 matrix with 4 numbers, versus transferring 4 numbers, right? In amount, is the same. But in the other option, if we know this basis and we just transfer like the same way we did with the colors, right? We only give the information about these coordinates. Someone else on the other side could, you know, if we transfer via the internet or something, they could reconstruct this image only with the coefficients. But now, in this second case, we only need to transfer the non-zero elements, okay? So we will transfer only 3 and 2. And I will, you know, we will see that, again, these ideas are, if you really want to have, or you have matrices that are very, very large. So right here, we are saving from 4 to 2. Well, it doesn't look like a big deal, right? But it's that simple idea, the same idea that we use for image matrices that are huge. So I work a lot with images. So I really like the idea of not being so abstract sometimes. And it has, if I have an image, I really want to think that I have this coordinate system of images. Okay? Sometimes it might help us to get ideas, right? So for example, here we can see that we have a coordinate system where things start kind of oscillating more and more. I don't know if you can notice that, but you see, here we are changing, for example, in this image, we change from the green to kind of a yellow, but not so many times. But here we start changing and changing more. So if we just look at the matrices, not sure if we will see that pattern. But by looking at the image of the matrix, right, we might see patterns, but just for us and to understand the math, okay? So let me maybe stay here a little bit and say, kind of repeat this idea. Sometimes we have we started with images and we saw how we store that in matrices, right? And sometimes we might be able to do the opposite. We have matrices and to understand something else, we might do images, even if the images really don't exist, right? But why not? I mean, if we went from an image to a matrix, we can go the opposite way. Okay, it might give us some intuition. Okay? Now, there is a mathematical tool called the singular value decomposition. This is a decomposition of a matrix. Okay, and I won't say much because I don't really want to go to very, very, very deep into details. But what I want to say is that this decomposition gives us a very particular coordinate system where the coordinates decay, okay? And of course, this decay depends on the image, okay? But because they decay, some of them are either zero or very, very, very small. So we can actually get rid of them, okay? So let me repeat that, but we have a decomposition. So I can take this image or a matrix, okay? Do this composition that will give us this coordinate system where some of these coordinates are very small. Okay. Now, again, imagine that we are transferring, right? So I keep talking about this coordinate system because I really want to see that, well, if we have the coordinate system, the only thing that we need are actually the coordinates, okay? So imagine that someone sends just the first coordinate of the system, okay? So you are on the other side trying to guess what is this image, and you say, well, you know, with a coordinate, and I know the coordinate system, this is what I get. Well, that's not good enough, right? We need more coordinates in this system. So here we, you know, transfer five of these coordinates, okay, the first, right, because they are in order, they are decreasing, right? So then we see this other image. By the way, I'm not clarifying, so let me clarify. Here I'm storing the coordinates for each of the channels, and the image that is on the left is actually this combination of putting the three channels together. Okay. Now, if we keep or transfer 10 of these coordinates, well, still not good, but you know, okay, you know, 50 of these coordinates, it's pretty, it's giving us a very good image, right? Good reconstruction. Or we are getting this image back. Now, this one on the last one here is actually the whole. So we haven't saved anything. We are transferring all the coordinates, okay? But here, what we really want to see is that we actually can transfer less, way less than the whole coordinates, than all the coordinates. Let me mention here that this image that I'm using here is the logo from the Mathematics in Fronteras program. And this was designed by Lee Trent. You know, you can check it out. This is a program where it's a bilingual program, English and Spanish, and it has courses that you can take. Now, still in this idea of creating coordinate systems for images. Okay? So I took this one from this beautiful book. If you are interested in investigating more about this topic, it's a very small and very clear book. And I want to take you, you know, take you to this first coordinate system. It's hard to see, but here if you have images, like astronomical images, where the boundaries or the pixels in the boundary are all black, okay, it makes sense to have a coordinate system where the images in the coordinate system also has also have that property, okay? Because again, remember that at the end of the day, we do this combination, linear combination, so we add them. So it makes sense if, you know, we are adding a bunch of images that have a black on the boundary, the resulting image will also have this property, right? So we can choose our coordinate system depending on the images that we are dealing with. I love this example. If we have a coordinate system of images of faces, right? So if we are dealing with images of faces, let's say for image for face recognition, it makes sense to have just our basis or our coordinate system being formed by images that are just faces. But I like this example to show you that you can actually do many different things, right? There's no only one coordinate system that we can use. It really depends on the application, okay? So, but the idea is the same, right? It's just having a coordinate system, okay? But if it's the appropriate coordinate system, many of the coefficients or the coordinates are going to be zero, and that's what we are looking for. So I want to mention Ingrid Dovicis, because she actually developed a very special coordinate system that actually has her name, okay? Dovicis wavelets. And these are a coordinate system that we use in our phones to compress images, videos, music, Okay. And I heard that she will be a visiting of in at the museum in the coming year. Yeah. Wonderful. You have to come back. Everybody needs to come back. Okay. So I want to change a little bit, and I want to talk about this problem that I work a lot in my research. You know, it's also a problem from reality, right? So we take a picture. Sometimes we are looking at something that is far. We try to zoom in, and what we, you know, the camera has limitations, right? So at some point you will see that things are blurred. It doesn't have the details. But actually, we can use some math to recover those details, okay? And that's the idea. But first, we need to understand how we model the process, right? So we have an image. So here, we just to be sure, this is created artificially in the sense that I'm kind of showing you an image, right? And then the blur, right? But you have to think about that this is the scenery. Right, this is the scenery, we take a picture, and this is what we capture. Okay. So one way to start is to look at the picture that has only one pixel, okay, and see how the intensity of that pixel is spread out to the pixels around. Okay. Because that is what is happening, right? We take a picture with a camera. The cameras have a lens. Right? And that lens, what it does is like, you know, the light is coming, and instead of going to the right sensor, okay, it's going to probably a sensor that is next, or it's next. So there is some spread of light that, you know, go to the neighbors. Okay. All right, so to understand a little bit more about how we model this, I need to define another operation between matrices. Okay, so far I only define how to add two matrices. So here I want to talk about convolution. And even though we are going to do multiplications here, this is not the definition of how you multiply two matrices. Again, even though we are going to do multiplications, this is a different operation. Okay. So, and this goes as follows. So we have this matrix and we want to convolve that matrix with this other smaller matrix. And the result is going to be a matrix of the same size as this one. So I want to think about the first matrix, the one on the left that we have here. I want you to think that is basically our image. And then we have this small matrix that is going to really kind of define the process, okay? So what is what the result of that is another image, another matrix of the same size. But something is happening to each pixel, okay? So we have this pixel here, it has a value, but then it gets information from the pixels around. How does it get the information from the pixels around? Well, it depends on this other matrix. Okay. So, okay, and the result of that will give us the value of that pixel, a new value for that pixel. Okay, but let's see how we do it. So you can think about putting, you know, this small matrix on top of this other matrix in that corner. So I hope the colors help to understand what's happening here, right? So it's like, you can think about moving them and putting them on top of each other, okay? Where the red pixel here will go on top of the red pixel there, okay? And then we are going to do multiplication, component-wise multiplications. So we are going to do 24 times 1, okay? Plus 23 times 1/2, plus 24 times 1/3, okay, plus 26 times 1/4, and so on. Okay, so that's the calculation that I put here. Okay, so everybody is multiplied with everyone. Okay, and we get just a number back, and that number goes there. Now the convolution is not just doing this multiplication in that corner, but it's doing it in all of them. Okay, so we are going to move this matrix around, okay, and get a new value for every pixel. Okay. So here I have just one extra step, right? So I move this matrix here, and we will do this component-wise multiplication and get what is the value of this new pixel. Okay. Now, I should keep going, but that, you know, I stop here, but I hope it's clear that, in principle, we will keep going. Okay. So, I hope it's clear that what we have here are two matrices, where this matrix here on the left, this image, is our image, and this small matrix here is the operator that tells us what happened to that image. So it transformed the image. Okay? So we have an image that is transformed by another image that is telling us how that transformation happened. Okay? So if this is this one is confusing, let me go back to here that is clear who is who. Right, so we have an image, and when we convolve with this image, we get our blur. Okay, but behind these images are these matrices, and the convolutions, the operations that we do, are the ones that I just described. Okay, so we have an understanding of what's happening with the, you know, this deblurring. Now we want to say, well, now we go back, right? So we know how to go there. It should be very easy to go back. But when we try to go back, this is what we get. Okay? So let me say that once again. We have a way of understanding how we go from a clean image to a blur image. So if we know what was that process, that it's a linear process and it's very clear, maybe it's, you know, we just try, you know, go in the opposite direction. Okay? And when we try to do that, this is the image that we get. Okay? Not very useful, right? So what happened? Well, the deblurring imaging problem is a problem that is called an ill-posed inverse problem. And basically what happened is what it says here, is small perturbations in the data, because this is data, okay, may result in large errors in the solution. Okay? Sorry I don't have time to say much more about this, but I hope you know, you are excited to investigate. There are some comments in the chat. Ah, yes, so how do you come out with a small matrix to get the desired result? That's a good question. And I have to say that we make assumptions, okay? In the sense that we might make assumption how, you know, we take a picture and we say, or we have an imaging system, right? Or certain cameras, and we might say, you know, well, we think that the spread of one pixel goes this way. In reality, actually, we don't know who is this blurring operator, okay? So the problem is way harder. We actually don't know this, so estimating this is a research question. How we can actually estimate this. Don't the entries in each row and each column, a smaller matrix, add up to same quantity? Excellent question. In this example, I'm not taking care of that because I just put some values there to demonstrate how you do a convolution. But if you are talking about this deblurring, you could see here, right, that whatever, you can think about this like a kind of a Gaussian or something that is decreasing, right? You will expect that the pixel on top, or when you go further, right, from one pixel, you get fewer and fewer information. So yes, they should, keep the same energy in some sense. So yes. So again, this is not exactly a PSF. Okay. So okay. So what I want to say now is, you know, we have this deblurring, we got this image that is not very useful. What can we do? Okay. And what we can do is actually to use this singular value decomposition again, but instead of doing this decomposition on the image, we are going to do this decomposition on the operator. Okay? The same tool, but we apply it in different parts. Okay? So again, before we have an image, we do this decomposition to try to reduce the number of coordinates that we transfer. But here we are trying to solve a different problem, and we use the same tool, but in a different way. Okay? And this is basically what it says here, right? So yes, so it is different. But maybe let me stay here again. There are many, many mathematical tools and mathematical ideas that we actually use over and over and over in very different ways, okay? And these are simple ideas, okay? So once we understand them, we can use them, okay? But we need to get there where they are very intuitive, and we can understand it in a very, you know, kind of like part of us. It's like, yes, I understand this idea, okay? And we do what we need, right? So I mentioned before, these are matrices, but if for me it's easier to plot the images to understand, well, we do it, right? I do it. So here is an example where if we take this decomposition and we modify the coordinates a little bit, we might get a solution that is not great, right? You will say, did you really deblur that image? Well, actually, we did the best we could, okay, using that particular method. I mean, there are many people still doing tons of research to trying to get the best accurate and fast, in a fast way, the reconstruction of this image. Now, videos. If you know, what are videos? Well, it's a sequence of images. So if we were very concerned about how to transfer images, well, imagine that videos have thousands and thousands of images, right? So we really need to be careful and think about how we are going to store images, videos, and so on. Okay, so let me wrap up saying, you know, all these methods and ideas that are used in science, engineering, there's astronomy, I talk about astronomical images, biology, medical diagnostic, autonomous cars. So there is a big impact on what we do, okay? And the ideas, you know, you can have these ideas. You can contribute too. So, you know, just keep that in mind. Okay, so the key takeaways are computers are faster and faster, right? Larger and larger. But we still want to be smart, okay, in the way we use them, right? We need to optimize in terms of storage, in terms of computations. Math solved tons of real life problems, you know, everything, you know, we use images all the time for something, right? So we will go to the doctor, it does this MRI, well, not every day, right? But images all the time because they help us to understand. But at the end of the day, these images are matrices and array, and right? So, but math has a lot of power there. And last thing is, you know, there are many ways to understand a concept. You know, I mentioned I struggled to some of the things that I mentioned today, but I found my way to understand them, okay? So I encourage you to find your ways and own them. So thank you. Thank you for joining us.